Hello and welcome to NPTEL MOOC on Applied Electromagnetics for Engineers. In this module, we will consider the simplest possible radiating element. This is called as elementary dipole antenna. And then we will calculate the electric and magnetic fields associated with this elementary dipole antenna at a far away point, observation point from the antenna itself. Okay. We will do so by first calculating the magnetic vector potential, and once I know the magnetic vector potential, then I will use the known relationship between vector potential A, the scalar potential phi, then electric field E and the magnetic field H. Okay. You might first recall the expression for the retarded or the delayed vector potential that I have written over here. A was the vector potential at any observation point r and at a time t. Okay. This I have written for the line current distribution because that is what we will mostly be dealing with this in this and the next few modules. So, there you have to, so apart from this constants mu naught by 4 pi factor, which if you wish you can take this out of the integral, what you see here is that you are integrating over the distribution of the current sources. So, this current source distribution I of r prime, except for the fact that this current source distribution or the line current distribution must be viewed not at the time now but an earlier time tr, and this tr is the so called delayed time or the retarded time, that is simply the time minus whatever the distance of propagation divided by the velocity with which these fields would actually propagate. Since we are considering fields in free space, in vacuum, or maybe you know, like once the radiate fields start to radiate, they will radiate into the vacuum, the fields actually propagate with the velocity of light. Therefore, the propagation delay between an observation point which is located at a length of L or a distance of L from the source is about L by C. So, the line current distribution is not actually looking as of now, but it is looking as it would appear L by C seconds earlier. Okay. And then you simply integrate over the current distribution, IDL prime is the source current distribution divided by 4 pi or rather divided by r minus r prime magnitude. Okay. So, what is this elementary dipole that we talked about? Let us locate a very small conductor. Okay. Don't worry about how such a small conductor can be located, but let us say that the size of the length of the conductor, which you can think of or which you can denote as delta L, is assumed to be very, very small. In fact, delta L is assumed to be very small compared to wavelength, as well as of course very small compared to the propagation distances that are involved. Okay. So, essentially looking from a very far away distance, okay, maybe the point P over here, which is our observation point. Okay, so, this is the observation point at which I am looking at this antenna, and you can see that the distance from the origin to the observation point is the vector r, and delta L is so small compared to vector, the magnitude of the vector r, that it actually looks like a point. So, this is essentially a point source antenna for us. Okay, so, this is the vector, this is the observation point. Of course, the actual propagation distances that need to be evaluated goes from the source point all the way up to the field point, right. So, this red line is the vector which is r minus r prime vector, which we can denote by capital R vector. The magnitude of capital R will be the distance from the observation point to the source here. We will line up this elementary dipole along the z direction. So, the current element that you are looking at will be the z direction current element. This is x and y axis. Of course, you also have the angle theta made by the vector r, that is the line or the vector from the origin to the field point or the observation point, that angle we will denote it by theta. Okay. Now, you have to imagine that there is, you know, a big sphere kind of a thing over here. So, there is actually a big sphere, okay, whose radius will be equal to the magnitude of the vector small r, right. However, as I said, delta L is so small that different points on the current source can be assumed to be almost at the same distance as small r. Okay. From the observation point, what we mean is that the length of this vector r prime is so small that the expansion r minus r prime, or the magnitude of the vector capital R vector, can be approximately taken to be the same as the magnitude of the position vector r for the point P, which we will denote as r itself. Okay. So, this is an assumption that we are going to make, and this assumption makes sense because we have a elementary dipole whose length or whose dimension is extremely small compared to this one. Okay. So, this is actually a good thing for us because it simplifies our fields and then gives a little bit of a physical insight. And the radius of the sphere, instead of taking it to be capital R, which is what you would have tried to take, okay, if the length of is actually different, now simply means the radius is actually the small r radius that you are actually looking at. Okay. Now, first of all, what kind of the field component should the vector potential A must possess? Because the current is lined up along the z direction, the corresponding vector potential will also be the z component. This is exactly the same as the short dipole that we considered, the elementary dipole that we considered when we discussed the vector potential. There we saw that the direction of the current is the same as the direction of the vector potential. In this case, it will be the z directed vector potential. Okay. So, that is one of the things. Now, we have to put some time variation to the current. Okay. The antenna current, let us say, is about I0, that is the magnitude of the current that I have, but I am also going to assume that this current will be varying as a sinusoidal function of some frequency omega. Okay. So, I have I0 cos omega t, okay. But this is the line current distribution as you would see at a time t, but in the integral over here, in the integral for the vector potential, this is not the time that actually shows up, right. The time that actually shows up will be cos omega t r, but you know what is t r now. T r is nothing but t minus magnitude of r by c, but in our approximation, the magnitude of r is the same as the small r. Therefore, this is t minus r by c. So, when I plug that retarded time or the delayed time into the expression for the current, I obtain I naught cos omega t minus omega by c into r. Okay, I have just expanded out the bracket out there. Okay, this term omega by c into r is essentially the phase shift that the sinusoidal signal has, you know, experienced. So, all that retardation time, delayed time essentially shows up as a phase shift when the source happens to be a sinusoidal current. Okay. So, if you do not like retarded potential or delayed potential, you can simply think of that same phenomena as phase shift of a sinusoidally varying current source. Okay. So, with that, and also knowing that omega by c can be written as the propagation constant, instead of beta, I am using k here. Okay, it is more commonly used in the antenna terminologies. So, omega by c is the free space k vector, which is denoted by k. Okay, and this I0 cos omega t minus k into r, now omega by c is k, can actually be expressed in the phasor notation. Correct. So, in the phasor notation, what will happen to that? That phasor notation will be I naught e power minus j k r. Correct. So, we have dropped the term e power j omega t from this one. So, this is the current distribution that is actually seen, okay, by the observation point P. So, by the observer, this is the actual current distribution, the delayed or the time shifted current distribution is what is seen by the observation point P over there. Okay. So, then what happens to the phasor, you know, vector potential? The phasor vector potential becomes Az at the observation point, okay, which is the point P, will be given by, remember there is an integral out there, but the integral really does not make sense because, you know, the current is uniform over the short distance delta L. Therefore, instead of writing this integral, I can simply remove this integral and multiply this one by the length of the antenna, which is delta L prime, or we will simply denote it as delta L. So, this will be mu naught I0 delta L e power minus j k r. This e power minus j k r tells you the phase shift that this, you know, the sinusoidal signal is experiencing at the observation point P. So, divided by 4 pi small r. Again, why small r? Because capital R magnitude is the same as the small r. But from our previous module, we also know that this Z component can actually be decomposed into two components. One is the R component and the other is the minus theta component. So, this R component will actually be given by, R is the spherical coordinate R component, okay. So, this R component will be given by mu naught I naught delta L e power minus j k r divided by 4 pi r, but this is a cosine theta multiplication or multiplied to that. A theta is minus mu naught I naught delta L e power minus j k r, okay, divided by 4 pi r and multiplied by sin theta. Now that I have a r and a theta component, we can go ahead and find out what is the magnetic field H. How do I find magnetic field H? I know that H is given by 1 by mu naught curl of A, okay. And as I have asked you to do, you have to practice a little bit of spherical coordinate, performing the curl operations. If you are interested, you can also perform these operations first in the Cartesian coordinate system and then convert everything into the spherical coordinate system. But that method is quite laborious, so we won't go to that method. Not that this method is easy, this method is also quite difficult, but this is the method that would give you answers reasonably simple compared to the system where you first evaluate everything in the Cartesian coordinate and then jump into the spherical coordinate system, okay. So, H can be evaluated by 1 by mu naught del cross A, and substituting the values of AR and A theta, and note that there is no del by del phi term, because del by del phi term is actually equal to 0. Moreover, there is no phi term, okay. The reason why there is no del by del phi nor there is a phi term for the vector potential, not for anything else, is simply because the vector potential will always be in the same direction as the current, okay. And it is not a function. So, the vector potential as you go around the short dipole, you do not observe that it is changing with respect to phi. So, therefore, there is no dependence on the azimuthal angle. The only components that this curl of A will have are the R component and the theta component, and unfortunately or fortunately for you, they both vary with respect to R and theta. So, the terms that you would have to include in the curl expression would be the R and theta components and the corresponding del by del R and del by del theta component, okay. So, when you substitute that, carry out the analysis, which I will leave, you know, happily as an exercise to you, you can show that the phasor electric field, okay, this is a clumsy notation for me. I am writing one bar and then I am putting a tilde notation over there, but please excuse me that. So, this is a phasor and this is a vector, therefore, this is a vector phasor. This can be written as j k I naught delta L sin theta divided by 4 pi r e power minus j k r plus I naught delta L sin theta e power minus j k r divided by 4 pi r square, okay. And what is the direction of the magnetic field H you would expect? Well, go back to the picture over here, right. This is a current flowing along the z direction, and the magnetic field should obviously be circling the z direction. Therefore, this has to be along the phi direction. So, this magnetic field is actually having a component along phi. And this is a very important thing, okay. Magnetic field has to be along phi, electric field has to be along theta, so that E cross H must point along the radial direction for the radiation fields to actually propagate, okay. If not, the radiation fields will be surrounding the antenna and they won't actually radiate away. So, the radiation away means that they have to travel, the radiated fields have to, or the power of the radiation has to travel along the R direction, okay. And notice that you actually get two terms over here. One term is some jk something, some constant, but the important point is that it is dependent on the first power of r in the denominator, whereas this second term here is actually dependent on the second power of r, okay. And when r is, or when you are very close to the antenna, 1 by r square will usually dominate, okay. 1 by r square dominates in the near field region, that is as long as you are close to the antenna. The word close is little vague at this point, don't worry about that one, but as you are close to the antenna, 1 by r square term dominates, whereas as you go farther and farther away, 1 by r term dominates in the far field region, and you are almost all the time interested only in the far fields of an antenna. Okay, so you design an antenna such that your far field magnetic field H actually falls off as an inverse R, or falls off as the falls off inversely as the first power of R. Any other power of R, if the magnetic field falls off, then it will not cause a radiation field. Okay, so you will see that reason why it is so in a short while, once we also evaluate the electric field. Okay, so now obviously the next step would be to find out the electric field. Of course, in order to do that one, I need to know what is the relationship between A and H. I know that del dot A, again remember this A is a vector phasor, so I wrote it this way, this is equal to minus j omega mu naught epsilon naught phi. Okay, again phi is a phasor, but it is not a vector. Okay, this actually is coming from your Lorentz gauge or Lorentz gauge, right? So we actually talked about this Lorentz gauge kind of a thing in the previous module, where del dot A is given by minus mu naught epsilon naught del phi by del t. Okay, so instead of that, I am written everything in the phasor notation and I obtain this thing. Okay, you can again show what is this phi by substituting or phi finding out what is the divergence of A in the spherical coordinate system, and it will give you something like, so this will be equal to I naught delta L divided by j 4 pi omega epsilon naught cos theta e power minus j k r 1 by r square plus j k by r. Okay, again you will see that the potential also has a term which is going as 1 by r and something that is going as 1 by r square. Okay, so this also has a term which is going as 1 by r and 1 by r square. Now that you know what is phi, you know what is H, or rather you know what is A, then you can find out what is electric field. Electric field is after all given by, so minus gradient of phi minus del A by del t. This is in the phasor domain that we need to write. So in the phasor domain, this would be minus j omega A. Of course, A is a vector phasor, so is the electric field E as well. And when you write down the expression for electric field after solving the corresponding divergence and other expressions, you will see that the field expression is given by rather complicated expression. I will identify the terms for you shortly, and then you have terms which are falling off as the cube, and there is a component which is along the r direction, very interesting. Okay, plus there is a theta component, which is what you want. Okay, so this is epsilon naught, because we are considering free space, r cube, sin theta and theta hat. Now look at this, the electric field phasor actually has two components, one is the r component and the theta component. Look at how r component is varying with respect to r. It is actually varying as the second power, inverse variation, but it is the second power of r, and similarly it is varying as a third power of r. So one term is 1 by r square variation, the other term is 1 by r cube variation, and if you go far away into the observation point from the antenna, 1 by r square falls off, 1 by r cube falls off even faster. Okay, so when you are very far away from the antenna, the fields do not have any r component, because r component would have completely fallen off to zero. And even in the component that is with respect to theta, you will see that this eta by r square term falls off, and 1 by j omega epsilon 0 r cube term also falls off at a far away distance. This entire r component goes to zero, and whatever that is left now has an electric field which is falling off as 1 by r, magnetic field is falling off as 1 by r. And these are actually very crucial, because electric field is along theta direction, magnetic field is along phi direction. If you don't believe me, you can go back to the magnetic field expression over here and then see that in the far away point from the antenna or far field of the antenna, this term which is varying as 1 by r square falls off. Therefore, apart from some constants that we have, this magnetic field is varying as 1 by r, and electric field of course is also varying as 1 by r, okay, with some constants which we don't have to worry about at this point. Okay, we'll worry about that in a short while. So if electric field is varying as 1 by r and is directed along theta direction, so this is my theta direction, so this is the theta direction, and then the magnetic field has to be along the phi direction, so I can't really show it in this one, so maybe this is the way I can show that one. So this is actually circling around, I mean phi direction will be along the increasing values of the phi. For a given value of r or a given sphere of r, theta and phi are perpendicular to each other and then they vary in this particular manner. But their cross product, which represents the time averaged pointing vector, will be along the direction theta hat cross phi, which actually will be the radial direction. Okay? And moreover, the pointing density will now be proportional to 1 by r square, because the magnitude of electric field is falling off as 1 by r, magnitude of h is falling as of 1 by r, therefore s will fall off as 1 by r square. Okay? And the surface area of the sphere is proportional to r square, in fact it is given by 4 pi r square. So if you look at the total power radiated, this is the power density, but multiplied this one by the surface area will give you the total radiated power, and the total radiated power will actually be a constant value, because 1 by r square cancels out with r square. So this is a very important point. Okay? The total radiated power, okay, actually is a constant as you start increasing or start moving away from the antenna. So in the far field region, electric fields fall off as 1 by r, magnetic fields fall off as 1 by r, power density falls off as 1 by r square, but the total power radiated and which is carried by the electromagnetic waves actually falls off or doesn't fall off and actually is a constant, okay, thus establishing the condition required for the radiation. Okay, we can't really throw away these constants, okay, so we will go back to them. Look at this, so you have some jk I naught delta l sin theta by 4 pi, indicating that the magnetic field varies with respect to theta, as does the electric field also varies with respect to theta, and both of them vary with respect to theta in the manner of sin theta. Therefore, the pointing power or the pointing vector also varies as sin theta multiplied by sin theta, which is actually sin square theta. So yes, the power is actually not falling off as you go away and away, so it is actually constant as you move along the radial direction. But if you fix yourself on a sphere, okay, imagine that you have a big sphere and then you are standing on that sphere and moving along the theta direction, then clearly as you move at different points on theta, the total power actually becomes different. Okay, it doesn't mean that radiation is not happening. Radiation is always with respect to the radial direction, whereas the power also exhibits a variation with respect to theta. Power or power density exhibits a variation with respect to theta, and the dependence of the power with respect to theta and phi, luckily in this case it is not dependent on phi, but in some antenna systems there is also a dependence on phi, in this one it is not, and the variation with respect to theta and phi for a given constant value of r is called as the antenna pattern. Okay, since we are going to look at the power pattern or power as a quantity, it is called as the antenna power pattern. If you want to, you can also look at the electric field, magnitude of the electric field or the magnitude of the magnetic field, in which case they are called as the field patterns. Okay, usually the field pattern square will be the power pattern, but it may not be always the case. Okay, so if you actually sketch the power pattern, you would see something like this. So this is the polar axis with increasing values of theta, and in the polar values, you know, there is nothing like a plus theta and a minus theta, or even the minus theta dependence would be the same for this. So you will actually observe that your antenna goes off like this. Okay, so it has a maximum radiation at theta equal to 90 degrees and it has zero radiation along theta equal to 0. Remember, your antenna itself is placed in this way, right? So it was actually placed perpendicular, I mean along the z axis, so you can imagine this way. So this is your antenna that has been placed, and this is the way your field pattern actually is varying. So you can imagine that this is coming off and tapering off into a point, and this is roughly the way it is, you know, the antenna pattern is. So along theta equal to 90 degrees you have the maximum radiation, but on the axis of your dipole, which is this one, there's absolutely no radiation. And the situation is the same if you take theta to be negative values as well. So in the negative values also, imagine that this is actually coming down and, you know, becoming a point here, and you see that there is no radiation when theta is equal to 0, but there is a maximum radiation when theta is equal to minus 90 degrees. So this is the perpendicular or this is the axis of your short dipole antenna, and the radiation actually happens in the plane that is perpendicular to this one. So in the plane is actually XY plane, and the maximum radiation happens in that particular plane, okay, along the perpendicular direction to the antenna axis. So please remember this, okay. So let's complete the power pattern. This is a two-dimensional power pattern, but if you look at any textbook, or you can look at our textbook, then you will see the proper three-dimensional power pattern. The three-dimensional power pattern would look, it would look something like this. So these are the field lines that you would see. There's absolutely no power at the center, so I'm actually not able to draw this correctly, but it would actually look like a donut, okay, not completely a donut, but it's kind of no power in the middle, and then it's maximum along the perpendicular direction, okay. In fact, you can calculate what is the pointing vector or the time averaged pointing vector. This will be given by half of real part of E phasor cross H phasor, okay. So we messed up with the notation here. So first a bar, then a tilde. So if you know what is the values of, or if you know the expressions for E and H, as we have already know the expressions for this. So electric field is given in the far field radiation as jk I naught delta L by 4 pi r e power minus jk r sine theta, and it is varying along theta direction. The magnetic field is actually given by, this was for the magnetic field, made a small mistake out there. So this was for the magnetic field H, okay. So magnetic field phasor, the electric field phasor is actually given by, or it's okay, so this is sine theta, this is actually phi hat for the magnetic field, and for the electric field will be given by j omega mu naught I 0 delta L divided by 4 pi r e power minus j k r sine theta, both vary as theta itself, but electric field is along the theta direction, okay. So now if you cross multiply these two, take the conjugate of H, multiply it with E, or rather take cross product with respect to E and then simplify it, you will see that the time average pointing vector will actually be given by eta k square, where eta is the free space impedance, I naught square delta L square sine square theta, this sine square theta is the power pattern dependence that we talked about, divided by 32 pi square r square, okay. And of course the pointing density or pointing power vector, the pointing vector is actually directed along the radial direction, okay. The total radiated power can be obtained by integrating the magnitude of S over the constant R sphere, and that you can also do, and if you do it, you will find to be eta pi I 0 square delta L by lambda whole square. This is an important quantity, please note here, divided by 3. So what you see is that the total radiated power, which we will denote as P rad, and we will discuss the importance of this radiated power in the next module. This radiated power is actually proportional to current square and also proportional to delta L by lambda whole square, okay. You cannot really increase the radiated power unless you increase the current, which of course costs you, because increasing current means you have to have systems which increase the, which give out a large value of current, and some of it might actually be dissipated as loss. And you cannot try to increase delta L by lambda, because the entire fields that were derived was under the assumption that the elementary dipole has a length which is very, very small compared to lambda, okay. So you see that it's not a very efficient radiating system. We will define efficiency in the next module, but as you can already see that you are not going to gain much if you were to use this short dipole or an elementary dipole in your actual practice. Thank you very much.